I'll quickly introduce Mr. Partha Sarthy, the moderator. He's a principal partner, Lakshmi Kumaran and Sridharan. He's a branch head of the Chennai office of the firm, while he heads the intellectual property division and is responsible for patent procurement, opposition and enforcement, advising clients and appearing in various courts for tax matters, both direct and indirect are also part of his repertoire. In addition, Mr. Partha Sarthy is actively involved in WTO trade remedy laws and customs valuation. He has represented a number of exporters, importers, domestic industry in anti-dumping, anti-subsidy and safeguard investigations in India, EU, Canada, Turkey, USA, Thailand and Korea. Before entering private practice, Mr. Partha Sarthy was with the Government of India and held various positions such as Accountant General, Director Railway Board and that of Director Ministry of Commerce Anti-Dumping. He had audited the accounts of UN headquarters and has been a UNDP consultant. He constantly lectures on various issues. His qualifications: law degree from the University of Delhi, master's degree in business administration from University of Hull, UK, degree in physics from the University of Madras, fellow of the Institute of Cost and Works Accountant, associate of Institute of Company Secretaries, patent agent, advocate on record, Supreme Court of India. Sir, it's an absolute pleasure to have you moderating this panel. I'll also quickly introduce Mr. J.M. Kennedy. He's a 1993 batch IRS officer. He's a Commissioner, Central Excise and Customs here in Chennai. Most important, he's been involved in the drafting committee of the GST law, and he was also part of the team that developed a new approach to taxation of services in 2012. So we are going to be hearing from the experts themselves. All over to you, sir.
Good morning to all of you. Welcome on behalf of the Taxsutra and CNBC GST Camp 2017. I thought we are going to generate a lot of heat during this session, but Hyatt Regency has preempted us. They have already generated a lot of heat. Be that as it may, very quickly, topic for the next 1 hour and 15 minutes is place of supply of goods, services and bundled supplies. Now, one or two words, what is the importance of this particular topic? As all know, the importance of this particular topic arises to determine whether a particular supply is an interstate supply or an intrastate supply. If you correctly determine if it is an interstate supply, what is payable is integrated GST. If it is an intrastate supply, what is leviable? CGST plus SGST. That is all the importance of this particular topic. The way we have tried, we have discussed among ourselves, is we are not going to deal with the provisions which deal with the various provisions on how to determine the place of supply of goods, how to determine the place of supply of services, etc. We are not going to deal. All of that is already in the legislation, which is all before you. What we thought was we would take up a few instances based on our experience where probably the answer is not that clear, or there are possibilities of different interpretations and different consequences flowing because of those interpretations. So what we have decided is maybe for the next 50 minutes or 55 minutes, we will pose a set of situations, and the panelists around here would be welcome to offer their views on how to determine the place of supply in those types of situations. And most of them are real life situations. None of them are an abstract or theoretical situation. They will all be real life type of situations. So that is what we intend doing for the next 50, 55 minutes. And then of course we will throw open the floor to all of you also to have a chance to interact for about 15 or 20 minutes. And we'll try to wind up by 12:15 so that the next panel is not delayed because of us. Before I start with a particular type of situation, I would request Mr. Kennedy, because he was part of the drafting committee, to say a few words about the GST in general and about this particular topic, and thereafter I will take over with reference to the various situations.
Thank you, Mr. Partha Sarthy. GST is a destination-based consumption tax. Now, many taxes which we were having so far, particularly levied on goods and services. Some of them were origin-based, some of them were consumption-based. In 2012, when the new approach to taxation of services was introduced, place of provision of services was also introduced. That was a consumption-based tax. If we analyze the evolution of the place of services rules after that, now we are ready. Certain modifications have been done in the erstwhile place of provision of services rules. So now we have full-fledged provisions in the IGST Act. Now, very importantly, when everybody says GST is a historic transformation, what is important is from the appointed date, everyone has to issue a GST invoice. So that means end of the central excise invoice, which is being issued from the year 1944. Now, in the GST invoice, one of the important parameter is place of supply. If at all invoices are being issued by a very clerical kind of a person, or we thought it is as good as issuing a bill, but now it requires a more intellectual involvement, because place rules are easy and at the same time they have a certain nuance inbuilt in it. Because for every general rule, there is also an exception given there. The general rules, what we have followed in the place rule, is that it's all internationally what is done, we have adopted. There is a property-based rule, there is a performance-based rule, and there is a destination-based rule. So these are based on international practices elsewhere. There is nothing new in this. But there are exceptions given to these basic rules. The exceptions slightly make them complex. And by nature, all of us know, place rules vis-a-vis goods is broadly easier. Because we all know where the movement of goods gets terminated by way of delivery, that is presumed to be the place of consumption. Whether he consumes at a place, whether the goods are consumed at that place, is not the issue. But the delivery is done there, and it is the movement of a goods gets terminated there. So therefore, it is very easy to presume that consumption takes place in that particular situation where the movement of the goods is terminated and delivery takes place. So therefore, it is very easy place rules in the case of goods. In the case of services, there is an inbuilt complexity, because the services are by nature intangible. So therefore, to pin them to a particular territory, you need proxies. Both time and place has to be provided for that. And within that, to determine where consumption takes place, we have a series of rules given in the IGST Act. Now, what I was discussing with Mr. Partha even before this panel is that the general rules guide us about the interpretation of the place rule. That is, we have to determine where the consumption takes place. And place rules are very important in the invoice, because that state where you say consumption takes place in terms of the provisions of the IGST Act gets the SGST revenue. So therefore, you are allocating, in one particular sense, you are allocating revenue, SGST revenue, to a particular state when you fill up that column, place of supply. So therefore, it is very significant, and it is very good to appreciate the broad thrust underlying that place of supply provision. That is, we are appreciating where consumption takes place in terms of the provisions of the IGST Act. And this does not mean that there are exceptions provided in the law. I mean, the general rule may not apply to all the situations. In some situations, we have exceptions. And the exceptions also have to be mastered. But I said in the beginning, it is a little more an intellectual exercise now, place of supply. So therefore, issuing a GST invoice calls for much more effort, to understand and interpret the law at a slightly senior level. So with these words, we would like to go into the situational analysis, which will say how the law applies. And that situation analysis would also throw up the nuances in the place rule. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I'm very happy that I'm the not a panelist in this, I'm only a moderator, because I can ask questions. I don't have to answer them. They have to answer all the questions. So with this, let's quickly get into a situation. All of us, till now, understand work contract with reference to both movable property as also immovable property. Now under the GST, work contract is defined specifically only in the context of immovable property, and by deeming fiction, it has been made to be a service, works contract to service. Therefore, question arises in the context of work contract with reference to movable property. For example, I have 500 computers in my office, 20 photocopiers. I enter into an AMC contract with some person. What is the nature of that AMC? Is it a composite supply? If it is a composite supply, what are the consequences? I'm not saying what it is. If it is a composite service, what are the consequences which arise out of it? This is one situation. Second, all of us today have a car. We go for repair. You go to the service station. He gives an invoice. Item A, B, C, D, 4.5%, 5%, 12.5%, 14.5%, separate itemized for the goods. And for the labor, is a separate service. What will happen to that type of repair service for which you now go after the 1st of July 2017? Is it a composite service? If it is a composite service, again, what are the consequences? So two types of situations I am posing. AMC with reference to a movable property, other is repair with reference, let's say, a motor vehicle. And let us see that what are the complications which arise out of this type of a situation. And I would request Mr. Venkatraman to say address on these issues.
We will classify it into three. Works contract, composite contract, and service contract, all involving goods. And service. See, Constitution says, does not make a distinction between movable and immovable under Article 366, 29AB. Even today, car repair is only a works contract under the Constitution. But under the GST, it is no longer. To that extent, there is an inconsistency between the CGST Act and the Constitution. It's a lapse. They should have deleted the 46th Amendment. I think they will rework on it. That's at a jurisprudential level, there is a disconnect. Constitution conceives as a works contract, a child of that Constitution, which is an act, conceives as a composite contract. To that extent, there is a disconnect. Now, let's be it so, we'll have to deal with a real life situation. Today, CGST classifies immovables as works contract and movables as composite contract. Now, what happens in the case of a car service, an AMC of a computer or a repair of a car, a pure AMC, a supply followed by a warranty and then followed by an optional AMC? What situation? The underlying test is natural bundling. That's the test. So what do you mean by natural bundling? And the Act itself gives an example. You supply goods, you take an insurance. You supply goods, you take a transportation. You supply goods, there is a banking operation. One cannot happen without the other. So, if you contract with the same entity to make both these deliverables together, whether you price it separately, you price it together, the law presumes it to be a natural bundling. That's the starting point for composite supply. So, in your computer or in your AMC of a car, because there is a sale for as there's a supply of goods followed by a service, one without the other cannot be done. It becomes a natural bundling. Now, when you do a car repair, it becomes composite. When a doctor does a heart repair, what happens? Both are only repair. You go and get admitted and say, yeah, they put a stent into it. It's also AMC. But courts have made a distinction between a heart AMC and a car AMC. That's the dividing point. And there is a fine legal distinction which all of us should bear. What is the difference? In a car AMC, the contracting parties have the right to pick the choice of the goods. There's a contract for goods, there is a contract for service, and the intention transpires between both the parties engaged in the transaction. And therefore, it was works contract earlier, it is now composite contract. But in a heart stent, you don't sit with the doctor and say, you showcase me all the stents across, I will choose which stent I want. The patient doesn't have the choice. This is exactly what the Supreme Court says in para 45. It says, intention doesn't transpire between the customer and the doctor. You come to me for a legal opinion, I type it out in 100 pages. You don't come and buy paper from me.
Is there a decision which says the human body is a movable property?
Yeah, it's wrong. It is inconsistent to BSNL. He is right. Kerala judgment says so. Kerala fails to understand that BSNL has suggested a completely different para 45. Sir, Justice Rumapal's judgment is on the point. So, when you don't contract for the stent intentionally as you contract for a car part, even though it is composite, natural, bundling and all that, it will continue to be only a pure service contract. Principle theory will not apply. These are the three distinctions I see as on today in this definition.
Gunjan, you would like to comment on this, Hussain?
Yeah, sure. No, very beautifully explained, but today I completely agree with the views that Venkat sir has expressed. What we are today trying to evaluate for everyone is the dominant intention and what would qualify as a principal supply. So as he rightly explained the situation of a car, right? What is important in that transaction, or rather what is the principal supply? Is it the supply of the car or is it the service? What bothers me more in this situation is, are we going back to the earlier issues of a divisible and an indivisible contract within the ambit of a composite supply? So, okay, we have achieved one step. We have, under the law, a clear bifurcation that works contracts are only in relation to immovable property. But have we created, again, a dichotomy by creating composite supplies, which are in relation to movable property, but under that segment as well, we need to determine what is the principal supply, and then once we have determined whether it is a good or whether it is a service, we need to analyze the place of supply. So would request some views on this.
You would like to add some?
In the Article 366-29A, there are six entries. Now, these are deeming provisions. We call it as deemed sale. So there are six situations. But if we read the CGST law, of course, the SGST law, which is going to come, is expected to be the mirror image of the CGST Act. If you look at the schedule, it is resolving these six entries into three each. Three are goods and three are services. And within this, if you see, restaurant service and works contract service becomes composite supply. Not all these, all the six. But works contract and restaurant service become composite supplies. And the rest are not becoming like that, because while defining the works contract, in the CGST Act, it refers only to immovable property and not the movable property. Therefore, the question comes about composite supply and the composite supply and mixed supply. Normally, a composite supply involves both goods and services. Even in 2012, it was part of the valuation rules, works contract and restaurant were taxed. The rates were prescribed, the percentages were fixed in the valuation rules. Whereas, as far as the other laws or other services are concerned, we were operating through an abatement. Because these two are very different, works contract and the restaurant service, because they are part of the deemed sales which is given in the Article 366.29A. Now in Article 366.29A, works contract and restaurant, both are having goods component as well as service component, states as well as center we were taxing, and that led to a certain level of a taxation of more than 100%, as someone would say. Now it led to number of disputes. But here, these two issues have been resolved by the CGST Act in the schedule by saying that these are composite supplies. Therefore, the issues are settled. They become now services, and works contract remains a service when it involves immovable property. Now, what happens in the case of repair and management? Repair and management has always been recognized as a composite supply. Because even in the Rule 2A of the valuation rules, service tax valuation rules, we were saying that maintenance and repair service involves a certain level of service more than in relation to goods. For example, every maintenance contract may not involve supply of goods. It's a kind of a risk pattern is involved in it. Sometimes you may carry on with the continuous supply contract. It's a 1 year contract, okay. At any time during the 1 year, there may be a supply of goods or there may not be. It almost becomes a risk coverage. So you give only if it is required, you involve some goods in the repair. Otherwise, it will merely be a supply, a service. That is why it is a maintenance and repair service. It may not always involve repair, but only maintenance. That means the service component is more. So if we look at the composite supplies in this case, the service component is always more in a maintenance or repair service. So the main supply is the repair service, and the ancillary is supply of goods, which may happen at times. So even the place rules, in my view, should follow the main supply. That is, in the composite supply, the principal supply is the supply of service. So therefore, that should be taken as the basis for interpretation of the place rules as well.
You know, you heard the experts and the departmental view as well. But from an industry point of view, I think till the clarity emerges on the legal aspects, we are not worried about, whether it's composite supply of goods or composite supply of services, because we are in business. Finally, I have to raise an invoice come July 1st. I need to have the clarity, and we need to take some, practical calls. And that's what an industry person would do. And what we have to look at is what is the, logic behind the economic view, which Venkat sir talked in the, morning in his opening address as well. So if there is no difference in the place of supply, if the place of supply is going to be same, whether it's composite supply of goods or services, and the rate is going to be same, I think the industry is going to have a huge sigh of relief. To say that we'll at least not be put into a litigation for the want of tax being levied on us. So I think that would be the simpliciter view from an industry perspective. While there could be multiple legal views on whether it's composite supply or mixed supply or works contract, from an industry point of view, we would like to come to the end result and see what is the end result from each of those, and each of those lead us to the same result. We would have a huge sigh of relief.
That's the ceiling point. If rates are same, natural, unnatural, no consequence. Rates are different, then you are pushing composite supplies to the pre-works contract era, Hindustan Aeronautic text will apply, dominant intention. It need not necessarily be only monetary value. That's one of the limbs. That's the test.
In fact, as they very correctly pointed out, what we want is a practical view. So today, I pay 10,000 rupees to Mr. Venkatraman to do the AMC of my photocopier. When he raises the invoice for 10,000 rupees, everybody is agreed AMC is a composite supply. Composite supply, which is the principal supply, and then he has to apply the rate applicable to that principal supply and charge me the GST on that. For this purpose, will he take the service as the principal supply? he does not know whether he will actually provide me goods during the process of providing the AMC, whether he has to supply me certain goods, he does not know. He may be supplying certain goods which are taxable at 28%, maybe some which will be taxable at 5%. So today when he is invoicing me for the next 1 year for the maintenance of my photocopier, which is the principal supply? And for that, as again, my view is, we do not know, because we do not know at any point of time whether certain goods will be involved or not, what goods will be involved, what rate. The real intention is a service. Along with the service goes the goods, depending on what we want. Therefore, he should probably raise the invoice with reference to the tax applicable on the service of AMC, etc., and then he will charge. That's probably what will happen. But the situation could be entirely different when I go for a repair. When I go for a repair, again, I may get, I know that they have told me these are the four items you have to replace. Each one of them may be one at 5, one at 12, one at 18, one at 28, and the service is at 18%. Then definitely there could be a problem. Whether because you have got four of these five, the value is of the 28% item is the value the highest, the labor charge is low, therefore I will go the dominant intention based on the goods, etc. And there the point which he made is very, very important. When I go repair shop, I still have the option to choose which one I want, what I want. Therefore, there is still a possibility of saying, I want a separate supply of goods with whatever rates are applicable and prepared to pay. And for whatever service charges you are providing, you still charge the GST applicable to service and do it. And that probably could raise disputes as well. That's probably what I think I would stop with the works contract for the movable property. Let's go to a slightly different topic. I am a supplier of milk. Mr. Venkatraman says, please supply one tanker, 12,000 liters of milk to me at my ashram in Chengalpat. Today you have the rate of tax, milk is zero. Transportation is a service which is liable to tax. Is this a composite supply? If it is a composite supply, is the principal supply milk, therefore no tax at all is payable of the entire thing? Or because milk is nil, remove the milk, still pay GST on the transportation service, or pay the rate applicable transportation on the entire value? So you're getting a situation where there is a composite supply, one of which is exempt, one of which is not exempt. How do you proceed in this particular type of situation?
Very interesting. The third scenario is far serious. To tax the transportation on milk's price, saying it's dominant, looks...
Nothing can be ruled out.
Yeah, no, I agree. In India, nothing can be ruled out. So, but this is an extreme view. I feel the answer could be this. There are two differences between composite supply and mixed supply. Mixed supply uses the expression single price. And mixed supply are actually unnaturally separate, but forcefully putting it together in a single price mode. Composite supply, there are two caveats, two doors to go out. It uses the expression taxable supply, unlike mixed supply. And it doesn't talk about single pricing. So you can have unit pricing. So a composite supply is only a combination of taxable supplies. So a combination of taxable and non-taxable, one extreme view is therefore you go out of composite supply. I have some reservations. They may still be composite supply, but you need not have to factor the exempt supply as part of the composite supply. It goes out. Now the third is, will it form part for consideration on taxability? Okay, you now do the plus and minuses. You arrive at a point, it is milk which is primary. Transportation is incidental. Milk is exempt, so no tax. Suppose transport becomes primary and milk becomes incidental. Transportation is taxable. So whether the cost of milk should get integrated into the taxable supply. So the answers are twofold. For elimination, exempted goods will not form part. you can bill it separately. It will not form part of a composite supply. And there are only two items involved, milk and transportation. Then there is no composite at all because it calls for 2+. Now, on the reverse, if something becomes a taxable supply along with 2, and an exempted is forming part of the supply, for valuation purposes, there is a bright chances for it to get integrated for assessment. This is my view at this point of time.
So the situation that is being discussed, in my view, I don't think it's a composite supply. The first submission that I would make. Now, essentially today, if we start looking at using the same example and building more on it, so if I'm procuring milk, I am not concerned whether he's using transportation services, whether he's sending a delivery man to deliver the milk. There will be n number of input services used to ensure that milk reaches my house. So, in this example, I don't feel it's a composite supply, but otherwise, if we have two supplies happening at the same time, building on the argument whether we can have taxable and exempt both supplies in a composite supply, the definition of composite supply, unfortunately, talks about only two or more taxable supplies. We would say that, okay, let's not have a restrictive interpretation. We can assume that maybe exempt supplies or non-taxable supplies are also included. But if that was the intention, in the definition of mixed supply, there is a reference only to individual supplies. The term taxable supplies has not been used. So, to my mind, when I'm looking at a composite supply, I would actually think of an AMC situation. Or, for example, let me take a live case where we have worked on a stem cell bank. If I have to collect stem cells from my patient, I need to provide a kit. Without that kit, I cannot collect the stem cells. That kit becomes an integral part of the storage service of stem cell that I'm providing. I would treat that as a composite supply. Unfortunately, the same plague, stem cell banking, exempt under the GST regime as well. Now, there are so many input services that I am availing, but because my output is exempt, I'm going to sit with a lot of credit. The cash outflow is going to be immense. So composite supply, to my mind, we cannot apply to, the concept cannot be applied to every situation. We need to see whether we are dealing with integrally, naturally bundled components of a transaction. There will naturally be n number of input services used at any point of time in provision, rather supply of goods and supply of services.
Just add to what Mr. Venkatraman said. When we are discussing law, we are thinking about extreme possibilities. But in real life, it may not be the case. Nobody would take a transportation where supply of milk will be incidental. Actually, it is what the supply is, supply of milk. And transportation facilitates that supply of milk. And if you look at the mixed supplies, what it says is that when you are providing different services, which are subject to tax at different rates, the highest rate will apply. So the idea of mixed supply is that you will have naturally different rates in the ordinary course of business, not extraordinary course of business. Extraordinary, if somebody tries to bundle this service, that service, different rates, I will try this way. The law doesn't provide those kind of options. It is very clear. If you put something at 28%, something at 18%, something at 5%, everything together, and if you are providing a service, it says the highest rate is going to be applicable to all. So that is the philosophy and meaning of the concept of mixed supply. Thank you.
And the key differentiating factor would be whether it is naturally bundled or not. If I go buy chocolates and candies and nuts in a packet, it is not a composite supply. It is clearly a mixed supply. So how I gave the example of a stem cell bank, those are integrally connected and each case needs to be analyzed differently.
You know, in a software development, there are various stages, of software development, and it would involve, supply of goods, in certain circumstances. We looked at an IBM case where the Finacle software of Infosys was implemented by, IBM. And there were certain developments which were carried out prior to, being given to IBM itself. Now, these are various stages. And you know, from that perspective also, you know, thank goodness the rate is going to be same in all the process. But assuming that it gets into this kind of confusion as to whether it's composite or mixed supply, we would have been in a very precarious position as far as software is concerned. You know, from that perspective, most of the discussion on composite and mixed supply is a little bit of an academic discussion as far as IT sector is concerned. But what is concerning us is where multiple states are involved from a delivery perspective. And that's where the concern of the IT sector comes, because we will not be able to determine the place right at the beginning of the contract itself. And then there could be certain places which could get added during the implementation process. And therefore, the place of supply, which I think we will get into a little bit of detailed discussion, I think that will be a critical aspect as far as IT sector is concerned. The classification as to whether it's composite or mixed is a little bit of an academic discussion, is what I would like to believe from an IT sector perspective.
Normally, if you have five experts, there should not be six opinions. At least five opinions are all right. Six opinions should not be there. But the why was this question posed, it's important. She definitely touched on it. Because the composite supply, when they use the term, they talked about two or more taxable supplies. If milk is exempt from the levy of GST, is it still a taxable supply or it is a non-taxable supply? If it is a non-taxable supply, you have only one, which is transportation of goods. Then there is nothing like a composite supply, as she rightly pointed. But non-taxable supply is defined as something which does not come at all under the purview of GST. That is how the definition of non-taxable supply is. Whereas exempt supply means a supply which is exempt from the payment of GST, which means it is liable to GST, but it is zero, or it is exempted by virtue of Section 11 of the CGST Act or under Section 16 of the IGST Act. There is a power to grant exemption, and it adds and includes a non-taxable supply. That is the definition of exempt supply. Therefore, sometimes what happens is we give extreme views to crystallize or clearly focus on the point. Therefore, what will happen in this type is, actually, the supply of milk is an exempt supply. It is liable to GST, but the rate is zero. It is not a non-taxable supply, something which is totally outside the purview of GST. There are situations which are given which are outside the purview of GST also have been listed out. Therefore, when you say it is an exempt supply, then what happens is it is still a taxable supply on which the rate of tax leviable is zero, in which case it is still a composite supply. And as Mr. Kennedy pointed out, supply of milk is really the predominant intention. Therefore, notwithstanding transportation may be separately taxable, the entire thing, if the principal supply is milk, which is exempt, therefore the whole thing will be under zero GST. That's how probably I would like to conclude that. Then, of course, again, there are views, counter views are possible. It all depends on the facts and situations. But what we wanted was to highlight some of these issues. Now, I go to
one take home. When you understand the distinction between composite and mixed, both use three expressions, one minus in mixed. Composite uses three expressions: combination, conjunction, natural. Mixed uses the expression combination, conjunction. Natural is not there. So the deciding, the game changer is natural bundling. Every time the contest between, for example, in an AMC contract with Partha Sarthy sir was saying, each automobile part at different rates, you execute a contract, it is a natural supply. He doesn't come there to pick different parts for him to work. He comes there because he's in a helpless situation. His vehicle needs repair. There it is natural. Whereas an auto dealer comes and picks up parts for his shop, orders so much of this part A, part B. There it is not a repair contract. There is no natural bundling. It's mixed supply. If he chooses to do a single invoicing, highest rate. Same parts in two different situations, when it is natural, that will be the deciding factor. The definition is clear. We need to apply it carefully. That's the take home.
Like as Supreme Court always says, it's very easy always what principle should apply. It is only the application of the law to the facts of a particular case where all the difficulties come. So we have this situation. Let's quickly move into one area where we have again a little difficulty. Assume I am the vice president of a company in Karnataka, and GST Taxsutra has asked me to come and chair this session. So I came here yesterday evening. I am now staying in Hyatt Regency. I pay them 10,000 rupees for the room rent. Assume today GST is applicable, so they charge me GST. What GST should they charge? Is it CGST plus IGST? Or because I am from Karnataka, they should charge IGST? Which tax they should charge? I am a vice president of a company in Karnataka. I don't have any branch or anything here. I came here, stayed for one night, 10,000 rupees charge, let's say 18%. 10,000 is 28%, no, today, 28%. So 28% will be the GST. So I pay the 28%. 28% is IGST, or let's say 14 plus 14 or some whatever combination of CGST and IGST. What should Hyatt Regency charge? And whether I'm eligible for input tax credit of that place of supply. It's very, very, again, a very tricky issue.
Give an interesting twist to the same tale.
See, normal tale itself is twisty. Yeah. He wants to give further twist to that.
Further twist. See, see, one is Parthasarthi star staying here. That's one portion. Now he attends this Taxsutra seminar, and there is an event manager doing it. Okay, and the hotel does a composite billing. If you read the place of supply rules, event management goes with place of performance. Staying in a hotel goes with the place of the immovable property. Now, you do it as separate supply, what is its fate? You do it as a composite natural bundling. This is a natural bundling. He has come here only to attend this, to do this program. So it's a natural bundling. So will it move out from immovable property to place of performance? Same transaction, two different halves of it. How do you deal with it? It's an interesting proposal. Now, this is one view. Now, the answer to his question, forget your credit. You're not going to get it. Simple. I'll give you a simple answer. You will have to forego your credit. There are areas where you will have to forego. This is one area. Because it is property-based and you are locational-based, a transfer of the credit, how do you expect Tamil Nadu to transfer the credit to Karnataka? They are not going to agree. They're not going to agree.
They don't get water.
You know, we share tears together, don't worry. So that binds us. Political statement. So now, therefore, credit is a real challenge there. Because we must understand the disconnect. Disconnect is one is place of property, another is the service recipient located outside the state. So if it is within the state, no issue. If it is outside the state, coming to the nature of taxation, merely because SAR is traveling from Karnataka to Chennai, it doesn't become IGST. Because the taxability on the hotel is only place of location of the property. So there can only be a CGST and an SGST. These are the three answers I have.
So this is a practical problem where, you know, we will have a lot of mobile people, right? Because for a company of our size, which has a pan-India presence, we would constantly travel to locations where we may not have registration. And so this, as Sir rightly pointed out, we are all capturing this as something which we would not get credit, and there would be block credits. And we are very clear that it would be a CGST, SGST. But an interesting twist can come if a person who is traveling from is part of a SEZ, which is a deeming provision on top of it to say it is an IGST only. And if the contract is there between an SEZ and the hotel, and you know, we get into a pan-India contract like a Marriott, we may get into room days, you know, 50 room days across you know, the country. And that's a contract between an SEZ unit and the hotel. And the billing doesn't happen based on each state, it happens irrespective of the stay, right? And that's an interesting twist, you know, which can come, where, you know, one law says it is an IGST because it's a service provided to SEZ, whether the place of supply has to be read and overridden and said that, you know, no, it has to be CGST, SGST because it comes into even or the property services.
SEZ because it's an exception. It's a good, it's a real twist.
Now, the more important than the twist is, it's the same problem which we encounter in service tax. We have to be very clear who is the service provider, who is the service recipient. His question was very loaded, if you had observed it. In the example I gave, I said, I belong to the company in Bangalore, but I came down and took it. But if the contract is between the SEZ and Hyatt Regency, the service provider is Hyatt Regency, the service receiver is the SEZ, not the individual. But what the Hyatt Regency will do is, location of the service, the supplier is Chennai. The place of supply is where the immovable property is situated, which is also Chennai. Therefore, you will still charge CGST plus SGST only. Therefore, who is the receiver of the service is irrelevant for determining the place of supply in this particular case. That's the very, very critical point which you have to know. See, the question which I had asked was with reference to determining the place of supply. Because the location of the service provider and the place of the immovable property is in Chennai, we said he will charge CGST plus SGST. That ends one part of the transaction. Then the person who receives that service, whether he can take credit of the CGST or the SGST, or whether that would be exempt or what will be the position, is a different leg of the argument which you have to consider separately. Therefore, it becomes very, very critical in this type of situation to have a focused mind on who is the service provider, who is the service receiver. For the purpose of tax, who is the provider of the service and which is the place of provision of the service. So all these minute nuances, I think we'll have to keep in mind. I think that becomes very critical.
Sir, the nuance there is also, I mentioned, irrespective of the stay, I'll be charged. Yeah. Whether I stay in Chennai or Bombay or Delhi, I'll get charged, say, 50 room nights. Right? The, and the that's where the,
answer comes. I think it's very impressive answer according to me. And the underlying fact is, who is to pay? The SEZ pays, then it is IGST. If Bala is going to pay from his pocket and then claim it from the company, CGST, SGST. The tiebreaker will be who ultimately the contracting party is and whom to whom it is billed and who pays. That may be the game changer according to me. Let's hope we have an extremely favorable officer today in the panel. I wish such officers replicate all over India and handle GST. We will not have any problems. See, you will make us jobless.
I mean, what Mr. Bala says is right. What he is trying to do is he is trying to distinguish between B2B and B2C. What is a business consumption and a personal consumption? In the provision relating to tax credit, it is very clearly personal consumption is blocked. Even where the personal consumption is blocked, because, for example, renter cap, because there is an overlap between, there could be an overlap between a personal consumption and a business consumption. Somebody rents a car, you cannot say that the cab was only used for official purpose. And the way Mr. Partha Sarathy may pick up some sweets in Grand Sweets and snacks and go back to Bangalore. So he's also doing some personal work there. So it is very difficult to differentiate between a personal consumption and a business consumption there. So if it is a personal consumption, it is going to be blocked. That is what the tax credit rule says. But imagine a situation where somebody from the company in Bangalore is having a direct account. Infosys is having a direct account with the Hyatt Regency here, and Hyatt Regency issues the invoice straight to Infosys. So it becomes a B2B. So there probably the situation could be different. Though the service provided is accommodation service and property-based rule will apply, the result could be somewhat different, I think.
The whole purpose is to point out there are still issues with reference to place of supply. That's probably, it's not, of course, a panel to solve all sorts of problems or what a situation. So I don't think that is a, and he was also pointing out another thing, event and immovable property, two separate law. In our service tax, we had a very specific tiebreaker. See, if two provisions are equally applicable, the one which appears numerically lost. Unfortunately, that law is not there. That type of rule is not there in the place of supply. So that's also an important point which is to be taken. Then there could always be conflict between the two of them. Again, no difference in rate of tax, no problem. The moment there is a difference in rate of tax, all these issues could surface. That's probably what we are trying to do. I think it's nearing 12. Last one more question I think we will do, and then we will go into questions from your side. I'm sorry?
Can't you take a casual taxable person registration?
Yeah, I don't know what to say. The casual taxable person is something, right from our VAT laws to sales tax law 1959, if you come for a casual purpose, you have to register yourself and pay tax. No, I'm not going to give you any exemption of any kind whatsoever. That type of situation is what is continuing even under the current law as well.
No, the business doesn't require any volume or frequency, right? So can't you take a casual taxable person registration in the particular state so that your credit doesn't get clogged?
I know, but what is the business output supply which you are going to do by sitting? I come here, yes, I take a casual registration, or the X, my company takes a casual registration. After taking it, I'll take the credit. What is the output supply which I am going to provide by taking the casual,
the fee that
for which I am going to use this input tax credit?
If in case you're getting some, if you're charging some fees for or your for training us.
Maybe, I don't know. What all that I'm trying to say is, like he also pointed out, I have different places with registration, but some I still don't have registration. If you don't have a registration, there is a problem. But if you can ensure that you can still take a registration and provide an output supply, then this SGST of Tamil Nadu will accrue to you here. You can use that SGST for paying your outward SGST of Tamil Nadu. Yes, you can definitely do. But it's not a question. See, it's one is a very, very valid question. But in the business situation, just for the purpose of taking a credit, will it be possible to take a registration as a casual and provide an output taxable service? I think these are probably issues which you have to, that depends again on volume of credit. If you've got too much of volume of credit, but you must still find an output service where you are able to use this SGST. No?
Sir, one key difference which I also want to point out is input tax credit is with respect to a taxable person. And each taxable person, although he may be part of the same person, taxable person is state specific. And even within the state, I could have different taxable person. Now, the furtherance of business, which is a key requirement under input tax credit, is with respect to the taxable person and not with respect to the person. So if I am traveling from an SEZ unit to Chennai, the SEZ unit should have some furtherance of business in Chennai for it to claim credit. Otherwise, if I have another, you know, taxable person in Chennai and the business is not overlapping, you know, because of the business verticals being business different, I may be denied input tax credit even on that logic, saying that it is not for the furtherance of business of that registration in Chennai. Even though I may have a registration in Chennai, I may take the CGST, SGST for the Chennai unit, it is not for the furtherance of the Chennai unit because I am a person attached to Bangalore, unless I am a head office person rendering, you know, services. Across the country, I may be, you know, denied an input tax credit on the logic that it is not furtherance of business of that taxable person in that particular state. That's a very key differentiation that may come up.
Though it may be so, but the way the law reads, if I have to govern, if I have to determine the place of supply, it will be essentially the location of the supplier. And largely every company is going to look into this point because events, trainings, and anything being conducted will be driven, either it will be performance-based or the location of the immovable property. So there is very less room for saving credits here. The only saving will happen if a particular company has operations in multiple states. What they need to do is ascertain such transactions where we have output services available so that we can maximize the use of credits in those locations. But in the present example where we are located in only one state, I don't see how we can save this tax really. That it is going to be a cost.
Yeah, my one question is if I'm permitted.
No, we will have one more issue because we don't have time in 5 minutes and then we'll close for 10 minutes for question and answers, the general thing. One of the other questions which keeps coming up is regarding high sea sale. Correct? High sea sale. So I thought I would close it with the high sea sale. So I'm importing certain goods from Europe. When the goods are on the high sea sale, whatever it may mean, I'm not defining that, I transfer them to Mr. Venkatraman. Okay? Are there two supplies or is there only one import supply and whether the answer to the question will depend on where I transferred the goods. I transferred the goods after the goods came into 12 nautical mile territory into the Madras port at that time it happened, or anywhere else it happened, does it make a difference? So on high sea sale, because so far, because of the VAT implication, sale in the course of import was exempt. Therefore, a high sea sale was also considered to be a sale in the course on which VAT was not leviable. And the high sea sale importer was the person who filed the bill of entry, and he paid the customs duty. And the boat circular is there, actually it will be 2% higher than the original purchase price, etc. Whatever the legal basis for that is how it was going on. Now, going forward under the GST regime, will there be an import by me which is an interstate supply and a further interstate supply by me to Mr. Venkatraman, or is there only one import which is an interstate supply by Mr. Venkatraman? And the answer would differ if I had transferred the goods to him after the goods entered the territorial waters near Chennai, 10 nautical miles from the Madras port trust. After it entered, then I transferred to him. Because of that, whether the answer would differ. I think that's the last question. After that, I think throw it open to you.
Take home. Three transactions are now taxable under GST. Sale in the course of import, high sea sales, transit sales. All are taxable. Please understand. Okay? And all are IGST transactions. Now, that's the first bottom line principle, foundational principle. Now, how do you develop it? Three variations we will take it so that there is clarity. Somebody sells in Germany and a high sea sale is effected at the discharge port by an NRI in Germany. Not taxable under the GST Act. Because it's beyond 12 nautical miles. Transaction two. Seller is Germany, buyer is India, and he effects the transit sale within 12 nautical miles, first high sea sale, IGST. If he's an NRI, there is a problem. He has to register in India because the transaction is taxable. So it doesn't matter whether he's an NRI or a non-NRI because he does it within the borders of India. This buyer does a second high sea sale within India. That is also taxable as IGST. You can send VAT it. Now, the challenge could be when somebody takes it in terms of Section 9 border case, either Gujarat border or Tamil Nadu border, then it becomes a CGST transaction technically, CGST, SGST transaction in terms of Section 9. So the first transaction will be IGST and the second transaction will be CGST, SGST. So what do you do with the credit? You can transfer credit, but the mechanism is slightly complex in terms of liquidation. Third variation, you pass through Section 9 and the goods is passing through the state to Bihar. So it continues to be only an IGST, not a CGST, SGST, even though the challenge of Section 9 is there. So will you tax one IGST in the anterior stage, one CGST, SGST because of Section 9, and one more IGST because it is going to Bihar? I feel there, the tiebreaker has to be because it is not meant for Gujarat or Tamil Nadu. It goes Bihar. It will be only one IGST followed by one more IGST and send VATable. These are the three variations I visualize at this moment.
I have a different view from him. That's the advantage of being a lawyer. The problem is we also had a lot of thinking, and this also to show that we did not discuss the answers. All of us had independent views. We said we will take whatever our views are. Finally, I'm only justifying. You may be happy with my reasoning or not happy with my reasoning and confirm the order that is different. He can do that. So the problem is in the high sea sale, according to me, there is actually only one transaction because and the IGST, what they say is a transaction of import is treated to be an interstate supply and will be subjected to IGST. And what is that? Till it crosses the customs frontier. Customs frontier has the meaning assigned to it in Section 2 of the Customs Act, which means goods have come into the customs territory, they will be kept there, a bill of entry is filed, basic custom duty and IGST is paid, and out of charge is cleared, then I take the goods out of the custom charge. After I take the goods out of the custom charge, it becomes a part and parcel of India. Any further transaction will be intrastate or interstate depending on further happenings. We will not concern with that. The first person, in this case, when I imported it, I had transferred it to him. He is the person who is bringing the goods into the customs area and he is filing the bill of entry. Therefore, there is only one import transaction in this particular situation where he will pay the customs duty and IGST, etc., and take it away. According to me, it does not make any difference even if I had done the transfer after the goods have come into the 10th nautical, because up to 12 nautical miles is the territory of India. Therefore, I bring it to 10 nautical miles. Now, theoretically, yes, 10 nautical miles, goods have already come into India. Therefore, there is a further transaction, there are two transactions possibility. But because of the definition of the customs frontier crossing and the definition of section 2, and also because the difficulty of determining when I transferred those goods, where were they? 10th nautical mile, 10.1 nautical mile, how do you find out? Impossible. Therefore, the Supreme Court said in Garden Silk Mills, we don't go into all those questions. We will only determine when these imported goods become part of the mass of goods in India. That is the situation we will go into it. This again, because the difficulty of determining this, in Garden Silk Mills case, the Supreme Court said that. So I am trying to use already existing or settled legal positions to say that under the GST regime also, if there is a high sea sale, all that the authorities will be concerned will be the transaction for which the person files the bills of entry for having imported the goods, and that would be the one transaction which will be subject to tax. And after that, if he moves it to Bihar, like what he said, I pay IGST, the SGST component of it will get transferred to Bihar, it will not retain with the Chennai or Tamil Nadu government. That's of course the difference. So I have a slightly different view on that. I'm not saying I'm right, but I'm trying to apply a certain existing legal positions to say that this is probably the result in a high sea sale.
Section 9 basically gives a share of revenue to the coastal state or the coastal union territory. That is the purpose of Section 9. Provided the place of supply is located in that particular, in the territorial waters, which is just 12 nautical fine from the baseline of that state. So if it is a coastal state, they get the SGST component. Otherwise, it would have become, if this Section 9 was not there, it would have become an IGST. And IGST, we all know, is a washout tax, and ultimately it gets credited somewhere where the consumption ultimately takes place. So therefore, Section 9's purpose is to provide revenue due to the coastal state or the coastal union territory.
So the idea behind this panel, because I'm going to close it down and open for questions. Like when you talk about transaction value concept or talk about the place of supply, 80-90% you may not face any problems. The laws are laid down. But all that we are talking about is those exceptions, because definitely exceptions are the one for which you come here. No? All those which are clear, why are you going to come here? So like the moment, because we are saying this, doesn't mean that the GST law, it's not good, it is not providing for all sorts of situations, or it is not for that purpose. It is to say, yes, in 90% of the cases, you have rules which can be clearly applied and the consequences are clear. But there are still situations where there are ambiguities, and of course, ambiguities to be there, because we also have to be in business, no? As lawyers, what we'll do if everything is clear? So that also is very, very important. Therefore, please keep this in mind. The purpose of trying to take some of these questions is to show that there are still issues which are open or which could be a matter of interpretation. That is all that I wanted to say to conclude our portion of it. Now I open it for one or two questions. That's probably what the time available is, because I've already been signaled from there. 5 minutes more.
Thank you so much for this good discussion on these technical points. I think the question is to Mr. Kennedy. I mean, having heard that there's still all this discussion brings out a point that there is, the clarity still needs to be given. Otherwise, it will leave for a lot of interpretation in the hands of the lawyers like us. And we will be more than happy to have such kind of confusion. But at the same time, I think when we have to see it from the industry perspective, is the government really taking these as inputs and trying to bring FAQ or FAQ in the sense that it has to be in line with basically the law. It should not be a general interpretation. So whether something is going to come out.
Yeah, thank you for that question. GST Council is still working. It's not that all the work is complete. They are still working, and government has made industry-specific, sector-specific working groups who go into these specific issues, and they are supposed to, and they are planning to bring out what are called as sector-specific guides, GST guides they are planning to bring out. I think they will address many of these issues. As you ask, they will be addressing specific issues rather than going into generics, which is all dealt in FAQ, which is already published by the CBEC and now updated, which is available in the public domain. So sector-specific guides should be able to sort out the issues. And still we are getting representation. Some of the representations are going to the GST Council and some of them are going to the Commissioner GST in CBEC. So therefore, the representations are coming and the working groups are still listening to it. I am heading the working group on transport and logistics sector. Our initial report was already given to the board and now we are working on developing the sector-specific guides. So we'll be able to go through the specific issues and give solutions to them. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, Article 269 of the Constitution was talking about the origin-based taxation for the origin-based states, accruing to the origin-based states.
Article 269, you said, sort of thing?
Okay, VAT laws was accruing, VAT taxes were accruing to the origin-based states. Where is a provision in the Constitution that's stating that this is going to be a destination-based tax? I don't find any mention, specific mention of the in the Constitution that it is going to be a destination-based tax.
See, where is the, it's like this. When you did it only for goods, you had to, it's a very good question in terms of the constitutional perception, I'll clarify it. Prior to the Sixth Amendment, only states had power to tax even cross-border transactions. If you see, it was power to tax on goods was only under Entry 54 List 2. You never had a 92A List 1. Then United Motors judgment produced a lot of confusion, constitutional bench. It said every state can tax every transaction. So contracting state tax it. Paying state tax it, banking state tax it, transporting state tax it. So multiple transactions on the same. This was reversed in 7 months by a 7-judge in Bengal immunity, which suggested interstate taxation should only be with the union. They brought a Sixth Amendment, amending 8286, bringing 269C, all this to say, all these transactions can henceforth be taxed only by the parliament. And therefore 92A List 1. So it was a carve out from 54 to 92, necessitating a constitutional route. Now both are going to do simultaneous taxation. There's no need for a carve out. Therefore it is governed by a legislation. You don't have to do it under the Constitution.
So from your answer, I have one question.
Yeah, and generally only to answer, in the normal parlance, we all talk about destination-based consumption tax, destination-based consumption tax. So I always ask, is there any change? Therefore, is that person going to pay tax? You know, it is still, I as the supplier of the goods or the services is one. So who is liable to pay tax and when is he liable to pay tax are totally different. All that is happening is, because the goods are being consumed under, whatever tax I collect, instead of remaining with the government here, it is going to be transferred through a mechanism of the government. That's all that is happening. But this is again to ensure that person will be able to get a credit. It is because of the seamless credit and the mechanism devised to transfer the SGST credit here from here to the destination state to have that seamless credit, We have given the name destination-based consumption, tax destination-based consumption. That's one.
I have a last question on behalf of all of you to a very fair officer. I'll put it on your behalf. Sir, now you are getting into a new mode of the center and the state officers working together. It's like the CBI and the local police doing the same murder case.
Has it anything to do with place of supply?
No, nothing to do with place of supply. My concern is for the trade. It's a new experience. So, have you prepared yourself, whether through the who is going to mastermind in case of a conflict between the state and the central officers in a particular state? Have you prepared yourself to, because this is going to happen at some point of time, an IGST, CGST, SGST problem will come. Have you got the remedial measures in place? Can you throw some light? How are you going to handle if trade is going to confront that?
GST Council is the constitutional mechanism available. So when there is a dispute between the center and the state on a particular issue, it will be taken to the GST Council and the GST Council will be dealing with such issues. So that is the ultimate solution. But for locally, it is important that there should be coordination. Department has recognized that, government is also recognizing that, and GST Council is also recognizing that there should be coordination between at state level, between the state level tax officials and the central tax officials. So therefore a mechanism, coordination kind of mechanism is being devised.
I think we have come to the end of it. You have one question?
Okay. Just
last question, because the panelists for the next panel have already come.
So just last question. He actually, Mr. Venkat talked about three scenarios. There is a fourth scenario also. I mean, apart from the sale in the course of import, high sea sales and in transit sale, what happens to the sale by a duty-free shop? You know, both in inward movement and outward movement, unless you take the kind of interpretation that Mr. Partha has taken. And one more to that also, that many times India is used as a transshipment port, where you can bring in the goods here and transship to Nepal or Bhutan, and you can say the place of supply is outside India, but then the currency of receipt is in Indian currency. So if you read rules or section 7.5, then it appears that the supplier is in India, place of supply is outside India, receipt is in Indian currency, so you don't get it as an export of services. So those issues are also actually alive.
So fourth and fifth, my suggestion would be, post the GST scenario, even Ashoka traders will be an IGST transaction and not an exempted transaction anymore. And if you are not going to get it in convertible foreign exchange, pay tax and take credit. That's an easier route. Because one of the conditions for export is receiving it in foreign exchange. Very simple. So these are the, so 4 and 5 will also fall in line with 1, 2 and 3. All these scenarios will now be an IGST transaction. Ashoka Traders has only said it based on the law as it prevailed then. It can't hold water when IGST determines that as an IGST transaction.
So on behalf of all of you, I thank my co-panelists for this. I think at least I learned a lot from the interaction with them and also during this session of 75 minutes. Thank you very much. Thank you, Taxsutra, for giving us all this opportunity. Thank you very much.